when I was first approached for this job by the U.S. Attorney, Michael Garcia, I was very reluctant. I didn't really want to come to Washington. I was very happy with my life. I was getting married. A big case I'd been working on for years was about to go to trial. And I was reluctant, and I basically told Mike I wasn't terribly interested. And he invoked 9/11 because the U.S. Attorney's Office, obviously, it's just blocks away from 9/11. And when that horrible, horrible crime was committed against our country, our office really led the law enforcement reaction. But I saw the senior people of our office sacrifice everything. I mean, working 23 hours a day, some for days, some for weeks, some for years. And Mike compared the financial crisis to an economic equivalent of 9/11. And he told me that it was my job, it was my duty, it was my responsibility as a prosecutor to react to this crisis just as the office had reacted back in 2001. And that really touched me because of that experience. It reminded me that, you know, I had to look beyond my sort of very narrow, selfish worldview, but that I had been given this remarkable experience as a prosecutor, doing securities fraud, doing mortgage fraud, the very actions that were at the heart of the crisis and would be the heart of this new program to bail out the banks.
Not just that. As a prosecutor, you also prosecuted the Colombian drug lords. That is, you tried to get them extradited. Did get some extradited, yes?
Yes, the Revolutionary Armed Forces of Colombia, or FARC, sort of the world's biggest narco-terrorist organization.
And you'd go down to Colombia and actually your life, you subsequently learned, was actually in danger and almost taken at one point, right?
Yes, there was a plot by the FARC. They infiltrated our investigation, and part of what we did is we interviewed a lot of former FARC. So they sent one of their terrorists in pretending that they were a defector and provided us information. And I met with her a handful of times, and her information was terrific. I mean, she really had the goods on the FARC, and we were able to corroborate it. And she became one of the handful of people that we offered to bring to the United States, put in witness protection to testify. And when she got here, she told me that, oh, by the way, there's something else I didn't tell you, and explained that she was a plant, and that on actually that last day when I made her that offer, the FARC had sent her into Bogota where we were doing the interview with the local militia, and the plan was that she was going to call in our location, and they were going to try to kidnap me, if that didn't work, murder me. So that was the end of my drug fighting days and why I moved on to doing securities fraud.
One of the things you write is that subprime lending was simply more profitable for the banks, and therefore they said to the brokers, we'll give you incentives to make loans to people that would cost them more, will cost them more than loans they could otherwise get.
Right. They had a term for it. It was called the yield spread premium, YSP. And they say if you qualified for a prime loan, you know, 5% interest rate, if they could trick you, essentially, and get you to take a 7% interest rate, then that's great. They would actually get a bonus for that from the bank.
And that's a subprime loan, the one that's 7%.
Right. Take you out of a prime loan, which would only be 5%, and put you into a subprime loan. That would be legal behavior. So as a prosecutor, there was nothing I could do about that. But what would happen is because they stopped checking documents, because they stopped really caring about whether the person could afford the loan, all the anti-fraud controls disappeared. And that ended up contributing to this great bubble, which of course collapsed with disastrous consequences for the country. But a lot of homeowners who got stuck in these loans were victimized. They were the victims of predatory loans. They were told, oh, don't worry about it, you'll refinance in 2 years. Or they were actually lied about what was happening with the loans.
You know, well, but these were liars' loans, many of them, which the homeowners, you know, went along at least with a obvious inflation of their own income, for example?
Well, I have to tell you, I saw time and time again when I was investigating and prosecuting predatory lending that often the homeowner would have absolutely no idea what was on the form, that it would be filled in by the mortgage broker or the affiliate with the bank, and they would just sign at the bottom, told not to worry about it. And don't get me wrong, there are certainly homeowners who probably did deceive the system and lied and contributed to that problem. But to say because of that, we're going to adopt policies that are not for the greater good of the economy. And more importantly, let's remember, the decision was made. The announcement was made. It was going to help 4 million people. So we're already across that hurdle of this concern about what I think is the mythical undeserving homeowner who's trying to get a mortgage modification. You know, a policy was announced. And then again, when it came time to enacting that policy, the decisions that were made were not to enable and allow that goal to be fulfilled. the decisions that were made were much more favoring from the banks.